For today's video, we'll be stepping into one of the biggest construction industries in the world, China. As of 2023, this industry is valued at a whopping $4.7 trillion. And by 2028, it's expected that this figure will climb by $7 trillion. To be honest, nobody needs these statistics to figure out that the Chinese market is booming. From the massive Belt and Road Initiative to futuristic smart cities like Shanghai and Shenzhen, China is redefining how we build and live. So that's what we're doing for today's video. We'll be going over some of the most impressive mega projects in Chinese history. From world-class bridges to dams to life-size airports, buckle up for a wild ride with us. Also, if you're new to this channel, subscribe to Visionary Builds for more exciting engineering content. We release two videos each week, so your support is much needed. Let's return to our original topic. The first candidate on our list is the Hangzhou Bay Bridge that connects Shanghai and Ningbo. It is a 35.7-kilometer highway bridge with two separate cable-stayed portions. At the time of its opening in May 2008, it was the world's longest sea crossing and cost $1.5 billion to construct. Currently, Hangzhou Bay Bridge is among the 10 longest transoceanic bridges. It shortened the highway travel distance between Ningbo and Shanghai from 400 kilometers to 180 kilometers and reduced travel time from 4 to 2 hours. The bridge has 6 lanes for traffic over a viaduct and 2 cable-stayed bridges over navigation channels. But that's not all. A service center for tourists was built in the middle of the bridge, offering shopping, restaurants, exhibitions, and parking. There's also a hotel and a 145.6-meter-high lookout tower from where you can catch a bird's-eye view of the bridge and ocean. All in all, this would be a perfect getaway for tired travelers to shop and relax. This service center was built on an island, which is a platform resting on piers to avoid obstructing the sea current in the bay. However, we would advise you not to be tricked by the pretty outer appearance of the Hangzhou Bay Bridge. The truth is, the construction of this bridge was no easy feat. It's almost like building a shopping mall on a volcano. The bridge is directly above the Qingtang River and Yangtze River deltas, which experience some of the highest tidal forces on the planet. The bridge's location is also prone to earthquakes, as well as extremely high winds during typhoon season. Understandably, the construction material for such a project would be different and much stronger. That's the main reason why the engineers chose a cable-stayed frame, because of its strength. Most bridges opt for concrete piles to support the deck, but for the Hangzhou, steel piles were deployed, which are relatively more corrosion-resistant. These piles, typically 80 meters long, serve as foundations along with most of the alignment, although some drilled shafts and concrete piles were used. It's also not surprising to see waves of 7.5 meters in length in Hangzhou, making manual labor impossible. For this purpose, two massive cranes, one of 2,200 tons and the other being 3,000 tons, were used to lift heavy-duty items. Offshore construction is a challenging task in itself. Most of the parts of the bridge, like piers, girders, and even the foundations, were completed on land and then transported to their respective positions. In addition, the weather in the Bay Area wasn't merciful either. It frequently caused erosion and cracking of concrete components. To combat cracking, engineers used low-strength early stretching technology when constructing box girders. This technology involves molding the girder and then letting it harden for 3 days, giving it more room to stretch and preventing cracks in the concrete over time. The third major issue was the underwater deposit of toxic methane gas in the area. No drilling activity would have been possible until that issue was resolved. To solve this, steel pipes were inserted into the ground, slowly releasing the methane 6 months before drilling. As you can imagine, this was a nightmare for all the crew involved, and as many as 600 experts spent nearly a decade designing the bridge. But winning against all odds, the project was completed in 2007 and opened to the public a year later. Next up is the Yangqu Hydro Water Plant. The number of crew working around the clock is, well, zero. Yeah, you heard that right. China's no stranger to building massive dams on its soil to power up its giant economy. The biggest dam in the world, Three Gorges, is built on the Yangtze River in China. We've made an exclusive video on this dam, so if you want to watch it, it's linked on the I button right here. Alright, so returning to the Yangqu Dam. The most impressive thing about it is, frankly, not its generating capacity or its size, but the way it's being built. Using AI and construction robots, The project is set to be completed in 2024. The heart of this project is the 3D printing technology set to perform the Tibetan plateau. For those who aren't aware, 3D printing involves the use of a robotic arm that gushes out concrete from its nozzle. The 180-meter-tall Yangqu hydro power plant is being built slice by slice, using unmanned excavators, trucks, bulldozers, pavers, and rollers, all controlled by artificial intelligence. When completed, the Yangqu hydro power plant will deliver nearly 5 billion kilowatt hours of electricity each year to the Henan province. In concrete terms, this means that a total of 100 million people will be able to benefit from the 3D printed dam. This isn't to be confused with the already existing Yangqu Dam, which became operational in 2016 with a capacity of 1,200 megawatts. This new power plant is expected to be an extension of the dam. Liu Tianyu, one of the lead scientists of this project, commented that he wants to free people from heavy, repetitive, and dangerous jobs with this highly innovative project. So, how's he planning to do all this without the help of humans? A gigantic central AI system will oversee each step of the process. The process starts with a fleet of unmanned trucks transporting the construction materials to the worksite. Once the materials arrive, unmanned bulldozers and pavers will return them into a layer of the dam, and then rollers equipped with sensors will help to press each layer so that they become firm and durable. When a layer of the dam is complete, robots will send information about the state of construction to the central AI system. The use of 3D printing will help eliminate human errors and will also serve as a blueprint for many other projects around the world. This technique is slowly but surely picking up pace with Europe and the Middle East competing head-on in this arena. As of now, a three-story villa located in the Saudi capital, Riyadh, holds the record for the tallest 3D printed building in the world. According to experts, once the dam's completed, it'll dethrone all current record holders by a large margin. It's safe to say 3D printing isn't going to die anytime soon, as it saves time, materials, and hard work. It's specifically preferred in the construction of bridges, viaducts, and other civil engineering projects across the world. Now, any list would be incomplete without the mention of at least one skyscraper. So third on our list is the world's third tallest building, the Shanghai Tower. Rising to a height of 632 meters, the Shanghai Tower shares the record with the Ping An Finance Center for having the world's highest observation deck. The tower has 128 floors, with the higher floors reserved for concerts and exhibitions. The observation deck is on the 118th floor. The outer facade is ideal for letting in natural light, as it's made of glass. However, the designers were also aware of the effects of heat absorption on the tenants. Instead of using reflective glass to solve this issue, the facade is covered with a double layer of glass, eliminating the need for either layer to be opaque. The tower can accommodate as many as 16,000 people daily. Designed by the American architectural firm Gensler, the tower's glass facade, which completes a 120-degree twist as it rises, is intended to reduce wind loads on the building by 24%. This greatly saved construction materials, as the building used 25% less steel than a design of similar height. The building's constructors save an estimated US $58 million in material costs. Talking about the interior, 9 indoor zones provide space for visitors. Each of these 9 areas has its atrium, featuring gardens, cafes, restaurants, and retail space, and providing panoramic views of the city. That's not all. The J Hotel in the Shanghai Tower is one of the highest hotels, located between the 84th and 110th floors. The mobility of the residents in a skyscraper is one of the main focuses of any architectural firm. In 2011, Mitsubishi Electric won the bid to design Shanghai Tower's elevator system. It supplied all of the tower's 149 elevators, including 3 high-speed models capable of traveling 64.8 kilometers an hour. The tower faced its share of problems, particularly after 2017. It failed to attract tenants due to the absence of all the necessary permits from the local fire department. Following a report in June 2017, approximately 60% of its office space has been leased, but only 33% of those tenants have moved in. Current tenants of the tower include Alibaba, Intesa San Paolo, and Albright Law Offices. Next up is the Chengdu International Airport. Located about 16 kilometers southwest of downtown Chengdu, it's one of the 2 international airports serving Chengdu, the capital of China's Sichuan province. As of 2020, it earned the title of the 3rd busiest airport in the world and the 2nd busiest airport in China. The airport covers a total of 0.7 square kilometers and features three runways and two terminals. Perhaps the most fascinating feature is the roof design of the building. It references the shape of the mythical sunbird, which represents the city of Chengdu. It features a central hollow circular core from which six arms extend, with both terminals mirroring each other. Apart from the design, it has an even more interesting history. The Chengdu Airport was built during World War II in 1938. At the time, its runway was only large enough for small biplanes. When the U.S. entered the World War after the Pearl Harbor attack, the airport became known as the Shuangliu Airfield, and it was later used by the U.S. Air Forces. It's now an international civil airport with flights to more than 50 international destinations and over 170 domestic destinations. It's a hub for Chengdu Airlines, Air China, and Sichuan Airlines. The airport can manage up to 60 million passenger trips annually and a cargo volume of 1.3 million tons. To take traveler comfort to the next level, the airport's connected to the inner city railway and the newly built metro line, making it a one-place stop for all local and international journeys. Which mega project was your favorite from the list? Comment down below. If you liked today's video, don't forget to hit the like button. It only takes a microsecond. What other Chinese projects would you like to feature on this channel? Tell us in the comments section, and we'll see you in the next Visionary Builds video.